Morning, one and all. The topic for discussion for today is laryngeal paralysis. So, first thing is we'll discuss about the muscles of the larynx. So, these are the muscles of the larynx. So, first thing is the abductors, that is the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. And the adductors are the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle, the transverse arytenoid or the intraarytenoid, you call it. And then the thyroarytenoid. So these are the adductors of the larynx. And the tensors, which include the cricothyroid and the ocellus muscles. So these are the muscles. So you can see all these muscles, oblique arytenoids, aryepiglottic folds. So these are the things. The anatomy of the larynx on a whole. So you can see the thyroarytenoid muscle, transverse and oblique arytenoid muscles, and posterior cricoarytenoid muscles with, and the lateral cricoarytenoid muscle here. So, okay. Okay. So the nerve supply of the larynx is mainly by the vagus nerve. So which again is divided into superior laryngeal nerve and the inferior laryngeal nerve, or you can call it the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Most commonly it is called this. So all the motor supply of the larynx is supplied by both recurrent laryngeal nerve and external part of the laryngeal nerve, that is the superior laryngeal nerve. So all the muscles are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve except cricothyroid muscle, which is supplied by the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. So that is the motor supply. And coming to the sensory supply, the above the vocal cords, it is by the internal laryngeal nerve, that is the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, and below the vocal cords, it is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So the this is the motor and the sensory supply of the larynx. So, okay, first thing is we'll classify the laryngeal paralysis. So laryngeal paralysis can be unilateral or bilateral and may involve the recurrent laryngeal nerve alone or the superior laryngeal nerve alone, or it can be a combined paralysis with involving both recurrent laryngeal nerve and the superior laryngeal nerve. So the causes of laryngeal paralysis are, so since it is something which is related to the nerve, so the nerve which is actually starting from the brain, so from the nucleus of the nerve. So there's something called the supranuclear lesion, which is above the nuclear level, and the nuclear lesion, which is at the level of the nucleus, and below it's called the high vagal lesion. And there's something called the low vagal lesion. And other diseases like the systemic diseases, which also can cause laryngeal paralysis. So first thing, the supranuclear lesion, which is very rare, and nuclear lesion, which includes the vascular diseases, neoplastic diseases, motor neuron diseases, polio, and syringobulbia. So these are the nuclear lesions, okay? And high vagal lesions. So high vagal lesions, it is the posterior fossa tumors which commonly causes the high vagal lesions, and tubercular meningitis, fracture base of the skull, nasopharyngeal cancer, glomus tumor, and penetrating injury of the neck, parapharyngeal tumors, metastatic neck nodes, and lymphoma. So these are the things which can cause a high vagal lesion, that is above the level of the ganglion. And below the level of the ganglion, it's called the low vagal lesion or the recurrent laryngeal nerve lesion. Because you know, below the ganglion, it's the recurrent laryngeal nerve which comes out. And systemic causes, which includes the diabetes, syphilis, diphtheria, typhoid, viral fevers, and lead poisoning. And other causes are idiopathic. Okay, first we'll go for the vocal cord positions. So Okay. If the vocal cord is exactly in the midline, it's called the median position of the vocal cord. If it is 1.5 millimeter lateral from the midline, it's called the paramedian position. And if it's 3.5 millimeter from the midline, it's called the cadaveric position. So in cadavers, when both the nerves are paralyzed, like are not in use, so it will attain this position, that is the cadaveric position, which is 3.5 millimeter lateral from the midline. And there's something called the partial abduction, so lateralization. So that's seven millimeter from the midline. And there's something called the full abduction, which is 9.5 millimeter from the midline. So these are the vocal cord positions which we have to know, because in different paralysis of different nerves, like recurrent laryngeal nerve, it can be unilateral or bilateral, and the superior laryngeal nerve, it can be unilateral or bilateral. So the vocal cord assumes a different position. So we need to know the positions first. Okay. So the theories on position of vocal cord in vocal cord paralysis. So there are two laws which determines the position of the vocal cords in vocal cord paralysis. So first thing is the Seemann's law, which states that in all progressive organic lesions, abductor fibers of the nerve, which are phylogenetically newer, are more susceptible and thus first to be paralyzed as compared to adductor fibers. So first thing which gets paralyzed is the abductor fibers. So later goes the adductor fibers. And the other rule is the Wagner and Grossman hypothesis is the most widely accepted theory. It states that complete paralysis of the recurrent laryngeal nerve results in vocal cord being in paramedian because of an intact cricothyroid muscle, which adducts the vocal cord. So if there is a complete paralysis of the recurrent laryngeal nerve, the vocal cord assumes the paramedian position. So that is, like I said, 1.5 millimeter from the lateral from the midline. So because of the intact cricothyroid muscle, which is supplied by the superior laryngeal nerve, so which adducts the vocal cord. So it does not allow the vocal cord to move very laterally. Instead, the cricothyroid muscle, which pulls the vocal cord medially. So that's why the vocal cord assumes the paramedian position. So when the superior laryngeal nerve is also paralyzed, the vocal cord will be in the intermediate or cadaveric position because of the loss of the adductive force. So that's why in dead people where both recurrent laryngeal nerve and superior laryngeal nerve action is not there, the vocal cord remains in the cadaveric position, which is 3.5 millimeter from the midline. Okay, so moving on to the recurrent laryngeal nerve paralysis. So it can be unilateral or bilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. So first thing is unilateral. So unilateral injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve results in ipsilateral paralysis of all the intrinsic muscles of the larynx except cricothyroid. So we discussed earlier, all the intrinsic muscles of the larynx are supplied by the recurrent laryngeal nerve except cricothyroid, so which is supplied by the superior laryngeal nerve. That is the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve is supplied to the cricothyroid muscle. So when there is a unilateral paralysis of the recurrent laryngeal nerve, the vocal cords assume a median or paramedian position and does not move laterally on these deep inspiration. So like we discussed earlier, in Wagner and Grossman hypothesis, the vocal cords thus remain in median or paramedian position because of the cricothyroid muscle, which is supplied by the superior laryngeal nerve. So what are the clinical features in a case of unilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy? So first thing is the patient will be asymptomatic. In most of the cases, the patient will be asymptomatic because it's just mere lateral. It just lateralized. That is in the paramedian position. So sometimes there can be a change in voice. The voice in unilateral paralysis gradually improves. Why? Because of the compensation by the healthy cord. So the normal cord, what exactly it does is it compensates. So since the paralyzed cord is in the paramedian position, the normal cord moves and compensates the gap. So that's why the voice usually gradually improves. So the treatment here, generally there is no treatment required. If at all, if the problem is much higher, you can do a lateralization thyroplasty. So you can do the you can lateralize the cord because it's in the paramedian position. Okay, the causes of the recurrent laryngeal paralysis. So the low vagal or the recurrent laryngeal. So like I said, low vagal trunk, which is the below the ganglion level. So that's basically the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So there are two different types. So because the course of the recurrent laryngeal nerve is different on either side. So on the right side, it is different. On the left side, it is different. Thing is, the recurrent laryngeal nerve, it's a branch of the vagus nerve. So in the right side, what exactly it does is, so the nerve, it winds around the subclavian artery and then it just comes upwards. So that's why it's called the recurrent. So it is going and coming up. So that is the reason why it's called the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So right side, it winds around the subclavian artery and comes up. In the left side, it arches around the arch of aorta. It loops around the arch of aorta and it comes up upwards. So the left recurrent laryngeal nerve has a longer course compared to right recurrent laryngeal nerve. So in the causes for right recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy is usually the neck trauma, benign or malignant thyroid diseases and thyroid surgeries, carcinoma of the cervical esophagus and cervical lymphadenopathy. And it can also be due to aneurysm of the subclavian artery, carcinoma apex of the lung and tuberculosis of the cervical pleura. And sometimes it's idiopathic also. And the left side in the neck, it's basically because of the accidental trauma, thyroid disease. So anything related to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, it can be because of the thyroid disease. And thyroid surgery can also be a cause for the left recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. And carcinoma, cervical esophagus, and cervical lymphadenopathy. So in the mediastinum, the causes for recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy includes bronchogenic cancer, carcinomothoracic esophagus, aortic aneurysm, mediastinal lymphadenopathy, enlarged left auricle, and intrathoracic surgeries, and can be idiopathic also. So causes for both, so paralysis of both the recurrent laryngeal nerves, that is the right and the left, it can be because of the thyroid surgery, carcinoma of the thyroid, cancer cervical esophagus, and cervical lymphadenopathy. Okay. Bilateral abductor palsies. One second. So bilateral abductor palsy, the position of the vocal cord will be in median or paramedian position. It is because all the intrinsic muscles of the larynx are paralyzed. So vocal cords, so that's why vocal cords remain in the median or paramedian position. Because all the intrinsic muscles are paralyzed except the cricothyroid muscles, because it is supplied by the superior laryngeal nerve. So it's bilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. So that's what. So the clinical features, which includes, since both the vocal cords are in median or paramedian position, the clinical features which includes dyspnea and stridor as well. So this is how it will look like on inspiration. So this is the paramedian position. Okay. So on expiration, there is only a small glottic chink which can be seen. So the patient will have dyspnea definitely. No, he's not going to breathe nicely. He will have difficulty in breathing, and there can be stridor also. So the treatment for bilateral abductor palsy, which includes, so usually 6 months is an adequate time to wait for any spontaneous recovery. So you can still wait for 6 months unless and until the patient has any difficulties, like any difficulties. So in acute stridor, if the patient comes to the emergency with an acute stridor, just go for a tracheostomy and just maintain his airway. If the patient does not want tracheostomy, following option can be considered. That is, you know, you have to do surgeries on the vocal cord. So that is called the lateralization of the vocal cord. Since both the cords are median or paramedian position, so you have to lateralize the cord so that you have some air spaces, so that the patient can breathe easily. Okay, so that is the lateralization of the vocal cord. The aim is to move and fix the cord in a lateral position to improve the airway. So the various procedures for lateralization of the vocal cord are arytenoidectomy, vocal cord lateralization through endoscope, and thyroplasty type 2, and cordectomy, and nerve muscle implant. So these are the surgeries which can be done to lateralize the vocal cord. So that which can be a treatment for bilateral abductor nerve palsy, abductor palsy. Okay, so now moving on to the superior laryngeal nerve. So superior laryngeal nerve, the motor supply is only through to the cricothyroid muscle. So if there is a unilateral superior laryngeal nerve palsy, so there is paralysis of the cricothyroid muscle and ipsilateral anesthesia of the larynx above the cord. So the sensory supply for superior laryngeal nerve, that is the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve, which has the sensory supply. So that lies above the vocal cord. So if there is a unilateral paralysis of superior laryngeal nerve, there it will be like the paralysis of the cricothyroid muscle and ipsilateral anesthesia of the larynx above the vocal cords. So the causes can be thyroid surgeries, thyroid tumor, and diphtheria. So most common causes. And clinical features, which includes weak voice with decreased speech, anesthesia of the larynx on one side, and occasional aspiration. So these are the clinical features for unilateral superior laryngeal nerve palsy. So the laryngeal findings. So once you put a video laryngoscope or a ideal mirror to see the laryngeal condition, so the glottis, the vocal cord will assume an askew position. So the anterior commissure is rotated to the healthy side. So that's the askew position of the glottis. And shortening of the vocal cord with loss of tension, and vocal cord appears wavy. So it has lost its tension and there is shortening. So it will appear wavy. So what happens is there will be flapping of the paralyzed vocal cord. So vocal cord sags during inspiration. So when the patient inspires, so the vocal cord goes down. When the patient expires, the vocal cord goes up like a bulge. So that's the condition of the unilateral superior laryngeal nerve palsy for the vocal cord. And if it's a bilateral superior laryngeal nerve palsy, which is an uncommon condition, both the cricothyroid muscles are paralyzed along with the anesthesia of the upper larynx. So the causes, which includes accidental trauma, diphtheria, cervical lymphadenopathy, any neoplastic diseases. So clinical features, which includes both the vocal cord paralysis, which occurs, anesthesia of the larynx, cough, choking fits, and weak and husky voice. So these are the clinical features for bilateral superior laryngeal nerve palsy. So the treatment, which includes tracheostomy with a cough tube and an esophageal feeding tube. So both the airway and the foot pipe has to be intervened with a tracheostomy and a feeding tube respectively. And you can do an epiglottopexy, which is an operation to close the laryngeal inlet to protect the lungs from repeated aspiration. Since the patient will have a repeated aspiration, so that's the reason why the patient has cough. So since the food enters into the larynx, he has cough. So in order to protect that, so you can do an epiglottopexy. So you tie the epiglottis behind and close the laryngeal inlet. So it is a reversible procedure, meaning you can always revert back to normal position. So combined or complete vocal cord paralysis. So that is recurrent and superior laryngeal nerve palsy, both together. So it can be unilateral or bilateral. So in case of unilateral combined complete combined vocal cord palsy, there will be paralysis of all the muscles of the larynx on one side except intraretinoid, because it also receives an intervention from the opposite side. So one side completely, the superior laryngeal nerve and the recurrent laryngeal nerve is completely gone, but the intraretinoid muscle, which has the innervation from the opposite side also. So the causes for unilateral combined, that is complete vocal cord palsy, is mostly thyroid surgery. So anything related to the vocal cord, recurrent laryngeal nerve or superior laryngeal nerve palsy, is mostly because of the thyroid surgery. And lesions of the nucleus ambiguus, which may lie in the medulla, posterior cranial fossa, and jugular foramen or parapharyngeal space. So any lesions here in the medulla or the posterior cranial fossa lesions or the jugular foramen lesion or parapharyngeal space, you can have a unilateral complete vocal cord palsy. So the clinical features, which includes, so all the muscles of the larynx on one side are paralyzed, okay, except intraretinoid muscle on one side are paralyzed. So vocal cord lies in the cadaveric position. So like I said earlier, if there is a combined vocal cord palsy, that is recurrent laryngeal nerve and superior laryngeal nerve palsy, the vocal cord is gonna assume the cadaveric position. So that is 3.5 mm from the midline. And glottic incompetence results in hoarseness of voice and aspiration of liquids. So the patient is gonna have repeated aspiration, and he also have a change in voice, which is mostly hoarse in nature. Okay, so the treatment. So the treatment, which includes the speech therapy initially. So the procedure to medialize the cord. So since the vocal cord is in the cadaveric position, so that is like this. So it has assumed and got fixed in the cadaveric position. So you have to medialize the cord towards the midline. So the aim is to bring the paralyzed cord towards the midline so that the healthy cord can meet it. This is achieved by injection of the Teflon plate. Since the cord is lateralized and lies in the cadaveric position, you can inject some Teflon here so that the cord gets medialized. So this is how the vocal cord is. So it has achieved the cadaveric position. So you inject something on this side, lateral side, so the vocal cord moves medially. So that's how you do it. And muscle or cartilage implants, same way. On the lateral side, you put a muscle or a cartilage implant, and so it goes medially. And arthrodesis of the cricoarytenoid joint and thyroplasty type 1. So that is called the medialization technique. That thyroplasty type 1 is also called medialization thyroplasty. Okay. Okay, combined. So in a case of bilateral complete vocal cord palsy, so what happens is both the recurrent laryngeal nerve and superior laryngeal nerve, so all everything is damaged. So both recurrent laryngeal nerve and superior laryngeal nerve on both the sides are paralyzed. It is quite rare. So both cords lie in the cadaveric position. So both of them lie in the cadaveric position, which is 3.5 mm from the midline. Okay, so there is total anesthesia of the larynx because superior laryngeal nerve supplies above the larynx, that is sensation above the larynx, and recurrent laryngeal nerve supplies below the larynx, sensation below the larynx. So total anesthesia of the larynx has happened. And clinical features, the patient will have complete aphonia. So the patient can't talk at all, as the vocal cord does not meet at all. So it doesn't meet, it just lies in the cadaveric position. It's not gonna meet in the midline to produce any voice. So the patient will have aphonia, complete aphonia. And aspiration, since it's open, so anything that you eat, it just goes inside the laryngeal inlet. So aspiration due to incompetent glottis and laryngeal anesthesia, and inability to cough because there is total anesthesia of the larynx. So due to inability of the vocal cord to meet, which results in retention of secretions in the chest, and bronchopneumonia due to repeated aspiration and retention of secretion, the patient will get bronchopneumonia. Okay, the treatment, which includes tracheostomy. So something which is above has damage, so you put a bypass procedure tube below the level of the vocal cord, that is tracheostomy, you do it. And epiglottopexy, so you suture the epiglottis, closing the laryngeal inlet so that there's no aspiration that occurs. And vocal cord plication, so you take both the vocal cords and suture it midline, so that is vocal cord plication. And total laryngectomy, remove the whole of the larynx. So congenital vocal cord palsy, so that can also be unilateral or bilateral. So unilateral is more common. So the causes, which include birth trauma, congenital anomaly of the great vessels of the heart. Bilateral, the causes include hydrocephalus, Arnold-Chiari malformation, intracerebral hemorrhage, angiocele, cerebral agenesis. So if you see, bilateral is mostly something central, so it's in the brain. Some lesions in the brain has caused bilateral vocal cord palsy congenitally. So that is, so these are the causes. And clinical features, which includes stridor and dyspnea. So the thyroplasty, like I said, type 1. So that is medialization. So when the vocal cord assumes the cadaveric position, you're going to do a thyroplasty type 1 to medialize the cord. Type 2, so when the vocal cord is in median or paramedian position, you're going to lateralize the cord. So that is type 2. And type 3, that is shortening. So if this is the length of the vocal cord, you're going to shorten the length of the vocal cord. And type 4 is lengthening of the vocal cord. So in those two cases, type 3 and type 4 is usually done for gender transformation. So if a female wants to get transformed into a male, so they'll do this lengthening thyroplasty. And type 3 is for pubophonia. Pubophonia, so you have a female voice for a male, so you're going to shorten the vocal cord so that he achieves the male voice. So that's what you do. Okay, so the picture, Okay. Type 1. So you're gonna lateralize. So you're gonna put an incision here and you add a piece of cartilage so that vocal cord gets lateralized. Here you're gonna medialize. Okay. And this is the shortening process because can you see the vocal cord? So here the piece is, the cartilage is cut from the thyroid cartilage and it has been moved inside so that the vocal cord shortens. The other one is suturing the thyroid and the cricoid cartilage, which actually lengthens the vocal cord. Okay. Thank you. So I hope you would have got a overall idea of laryngeal palsy. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.